Morning, everybody. I want to welcome you here to worship this morning. If you're visiting with us, we want to encourage you to stop by the Welcome Center following worship. We have a gift for you there and an opportunity for you to learn a little bit more about the ministries of First Church here and some of our core beliefs. So make sure you stop by the Welcome Center following worship today. This morning, we're kicking off a new sermon series that's going to be a church-wide study. In fact, as mentioned earlier, Pastor Steve and I will be co-teaching a class on Wednesday night that'll be going even deeper than what we're jumping to here on Sunday mornings. And I invite you to, again, stop by the Welcome Center following worship to get signed up for that class. We really only have about 30 minutes or so to really touch on some of these topics on Sunday morning, and Wednesday night is an opportunity for you to go much deeper and experience the transforming love of God. So I invite you to do that. You know, this morning I'm starting off talking about something that's kind of very near and dear to me, and that's my dad. My dad made it into a lot of my sermons in Marengo. He actually, I threw him under the bus quite a bit in love, and he actually told me that the congregation in Marengo probably knows more about him than my mom at this point. But I do that because my dad is the kind of guy that I want to be. I joke with him and I tease him a lot, but my dad is my best friend in the entire world. In fact, he was the best man at my wedding, and he's still my best man even today. But my dad also has some funny tendencies, I also have to admit. My dad is also ADD. Maybe it's hereditary, I don't know. But he's always on the go. He's not one of those guys who sits still very, very well. And if he was preaching here this morning, he'd probably put more laps on this stage than I do on a Sunday morning. But I texted my dad this morning, and I asked him, you know, when did you retire? My dad's been retired for a few years now, and it wasn't even 30 seconds. He texted me back. He said, I retired on August 31st, 2013. He knew the date. Maybe he even knows the time that he put his retirement letter across the desk to his boss. But my dad served his country in the Air Force for 4 years and then served for over 30 years as a civilian employee to the Army as a financial specialist. And upon his retirement, my dad said he was going to buy himself a retirement present. And he bought himself an old 1965 Chevy Impala SS. Now, isn't that pretty? It didn't look like that when he bought it. Let me just put this out there. He says it was his retirement gift to himself. I said it was his midlife crisis. You can determine for yourself what that may really be, but you know, he bought this thing and he was really excited about it because this is actually the same car that he bought. This was his first car, and he wanted this again when he retired or when he entered his midlife crisis or however you may want to interpret that. But for the first week of that he had this thing, it ran great, and boy was it loud. Our neighbors were so angry. It was so awesome to hear this thing roaring down the road. But, you know, it didn't look that great when he first got it. It had a lot of the wiring had to be redone on it. In fact, last week my dad was telling me he smelled smoke inside of the interior and found out he had a wire shorting out. So it's not all perfect yet, that's for sure. But the paint was dirty. It was grimy. It had to be buffed out. There were rust spots on it that had to be sanded and bondoed out. It looks pretty good now, though, doesn't it? Isn't that a sweet car? He even let me drive it once. Once. I thought I was his favorite, too, but I guess not. I don't know. But when Dad was restoring this car, we came to find out that this car is an absolute masterpiece now. I mean, when you look at it, there's really no blemishes in it, other than sometimes it doesn't run the greatest. He's still working on a few things on this. And in fact, I talked to some other people in our congregation that enjoy restoring stuff also. I'm thinking particularly of Randy Blackford. You guys know Randy. He's the chair of the trustees here at our church. And when his father passed away, he inherited his dad's, I think it's a 1940s or 30s Ford. And that thing is just gorgeous, and he's had a great time doing it. But a lot of times when we begin these projects, they don't begin the way that they end, do they? They don't begin the way that they end. And as my dad was assessing this, he had to ask himself three questions. Okay, go to that next slide. He had to ask himself these three questions if he was going to ever get to the end of this project. He said, "How bad is the problem? What can we do to solve the problem? And most importantly, how can we keep from having these problems again, like smoke flooding the interior of the car from wires shorting out?" We haven't got there all the way. But this relates to you, I think, because there's two fundamental truths that I want to share with you this morning, and that is that you too are an absolute masterpiece. Do you know this? Check out Ephesians chapter 2. "For we are God's" what? "Handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." Some translations translate that as "we are God's handiwork, we are God's masterpiece, we are God's craftsmanship," or workmanship is how that can also be translated. And I want you to hold on to that this morning, that you indeed are a masterpiece. And you know what? The world can be really good at beating us down and trying to make us feel less than that. But look around yourselves this morning. You are also surrounded by God's masterpieces. Turn to someone next to you and tell them that they are a masterpiece. Would you do that? That's good. Now, I apologize if you're watching on the internet later this week. You just have to look at me and take my word for it. Blemishes and all. But you are made by a God who loves you to the uttermost, who will never let you go, a God in whom the angels veil their faces in his presence. Do you realize this? If you read Genesis chapter 2, the story of creation, it reads that God took dust from the earth, and molded it into humankind and breathed his breath into us, breathe this very breath, the very spirit of God into each and every single one of us. We were created in the image of God. You have the image of God imprinted on you. Do you realize this? I mean, that's nice to talk about, right? I mean, it's great theory, but when you really harness this, when you really embrace that and think about this, that you are made with the very image of the God of the universe, and God looks upon humankind and says, "That is the crown jewel of everything that I've done." You are a masterpiece. You need to hold on to that this morning, because so many of us walk through life thinking that we're less than, and maybe that's because of the way that we were raised, or maybe it's the people that have surrounded us, or maybe we didn't get that promotion, or whatever that may be. And so oftentimes we lose this fundamental truth of our worth, that God looks upon us and says, "Oh, that's good stuff." You are a masterpiece. But here's the other truth. While we are created in the image of God, due to our fallenness, due to our human condition, much like this 65 Impala, many of us are covered in dents. Many of us are covered in dirt and dust and grime. You know, I think it doesn't take long to figure this out from the biblical perspective. If you look at Romans 3:23, that's not Romans 3:23, but I'll tell you exactly what it says. Romans 3:23 says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We all find ourselves in this predicament, that we're all sinners in need of grace, and we've fallen short of the glory of God. Even though we are imprinted with God's image through our waywardness, through our wandering, the image of God has been darkened in our lives. But here's the hope for you this morning. It has never been destroyed. And even in our brokenness, even in our dirtiness and the grime that's on our lives, God still claims us as God's masterpiece. If you were here on Wednesday night, you heard Steve and I sing this song by the band Gunger. And the chorus line goes, "You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of dust." Do you realize we all come from the same stuff? I mean, you look around here and y'all look pretty different. But foundationally, we all come from the same stuff. We are dust. And you heard on Wednesday night, from dust you came, to dust you will return. Repent or turn from your sin and believe in the gospel. That's what the season of Lent is all about. It's recognizing our mortality. First of all, we are dependent upon the God of the universe for our comings and our goings. Psalms 121 says, "The Lord watches over your coming and going now and forevermore," which also tells us that there's no place that we can be where we're outside the scope and grasp of God's love for you. So, I mean, hold on to that as well. But we are completely dependent upon the God of the universe for our life, for our sustenance, for everything that we have, for everything that we breathe. And yet, We are dust. We come from this, and that is to where we will return, to repent and believe in the good news of the gospel. That's the hope of Lent. But I trust that if you're here this morning, that you may recognize some areas in your own life that are dented, that are darkened but not destroyed, that are dirty, that are grimy. But if you're here this morning, I trust that you are looking for restoration, that you too want to be restored. And the good news of the gospel in Jesus Christ and through the power of the cross, that can be your truth. That can be your truth. But you got to get there by asking yourself those three questions. You know, how bad is the problem? Whatever that grime, whatever that dust, whatever that dent may be in your life, how bad is the problem? What can you do to solve the problem? And how can we keep from having this problem again? You know, the problem with churches and congregations and doing life together like this is we just have to get honest about our mess. You know, and people can be a real mess. We can be a real mess. I was in True Value hardware store last year in Marengo, and I was buying a fishing license. And the guy who was selling me the license recognized me because my church was right across the street. So he saw me going in and out of this building every day. But I don't look like a pastor, praise the Lord. Being a pastor can really get in the way of doing ministry sometimes. Have I ever told you this? That sometimes people see you as a pastor, all of a sudden you get this halo complex and people think you glow white and you don't have dust, dirt, grime in your own life. And the truth is, no different than the rest of y'all. We all got this. We all have to deal with this situation. I think we're all seeking restoration. But I walked into True Value Hardware and he's like, "Pastor, on deck." Like something significant had happened. And I went up and I told him I wanted to buy this fishing license. And he says, "Well, I thought the Bible said you're supposed to be fishing for people. What are you doing out on the lake?" Which was really funny to me. And we got into this conversation about what it was like to be in ministry and doing faith and life together. And he's like, "You know, I believe in the gospel. I love Jesus Christ. You know, Christ is in my life. But here's the problem. I don't like going to church." I said, "Why is that?" He's like, "Because it's full of hypocrites." And I said, "And we can always use one more of those." Huh? I mean, when we realize and recognize our place this Lent, each and every single one of us are dirty, we're dented, we're broken, we're damaged. But yet, God looks upon you and says, "Ooh, that is my masterpiece." And it's through the hope and the cross of Jesus Christ that you can experience transformation and be restored to that original masterpiece God created you to be by being liberated from the fear of death, by being liberated from the grime of sin. And that masterpiece begins to shine through. So that's, I want you to hold on to that fundamental truth this morning, that you indeed are a masterpiece. But here's the other thing that I want us to get very honest about. Is that we need to get honest that sin messes up this masterpiece. That it darkens the image of God. It will never destroy it. But it gets in the way of what God intends for our lives. To have full, fruitful, joyful, and abundant lives. You know, it's amazing to me that, you know, we have depression rates are at an all-time high. We are at a state in worldwide society where suicide outnumbers homicide. Did you know that? And this is never the way that God intended for us to be. God, I mean, Jesus makes it clear that in me you will have life and you will have it abundantly, that my joy would be made complete in you. But we also have to get honest that the mess gets in the way and robs our joy, robs us from what God has intended us to be. And without acknowledging the mess, hear me on this, friends, the season of Lent will have no power in your life. It just won't have any power. And I want us to recognize that even our best, even our good, isn't really all that great. You know what I mean? Check out Isaiah. Do we have that passage? Isaiah 64, verse 6. Oh, we do have it. It says this: all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. Does that passage get honest about the mess or what? It just sweeps us away. And I think what's worse is that sometimes, I mean, acknowledging the mess in our own life is really difficult, but I always find it much easier to acknowledge Nancy's mess. You know, it's much easier for me to see the mess in her life rather than to have the struggle of looking inward and dealing with my own. We call that displacement, and church people are really good at that too, aren't we? We're so quick to point fingers and say, oh, like the Pharisee, oh gosh, I'm so glad that I'm not as broken and as dented as Leslie. Man, she's really messed up. She makes me look good. Yeah. I'm kidding. Leslie is a saint. But we're so good at this. I mean, imagine, we saw this on video this morning, and Jesus is talking about two people. He's talking about a tax collector who's considered to be the worst of the worst in the society that they were in at that time, and they're talking about a Pharisee who's supposed to be the most adherent religious person to the rules and getting it right and training other people up in righteousness. And yet Jesus says it was the Pharisee that was wrong all along, because the Pharisee was really good at acknowledging everyone else's mess without looking in. I mean, can you imagine me coming in on Sunday morning and saying, you know, Janet's the worst. I mean, she really is the worst. She's got this wrong with her. She's got this wrong with her. And let's just go from person to person and just call it out. I mean, pretty self-righteous, right? Take a look at this video. Oh, look, it's Jesus, and he said, stop it! the word of the Lord. Yeah. You know, I mean, that obviously an extreme and a humorous example, but not too far off from what we're dealing with in the gospel reading today from Luke chapter 18. Jesus talks about the danger of seeing other people's junk, seeing other people's mess and not our own. Again, in this passage, we have two characters. We have the Pharisee and we have a tax collector, Jesus says. Now, what you need to know about Pharisees is, like, the great 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 grandchildren of Pharisees are now Orthodox Jews. Okay, if that kind of gives you an idea, these are the kind of guys who have very strict dress, who don't cut their hair, who braid their sideburns. I don't even know if I could pull that off, honestly. But they look at the law and they adhere to every ounce, every detail of the law. This is Orthodox Jewish belief, and they're responsible for keeping this law. God gave us these laws to set us apart and to make the nation of Israel holy and its people. And we said last week that God said it. I believe that settles it. Probably isn't as simple as we all want it to be. But they're serious. They're very serious about keeping the law. But here's what I want to point out to you. Here's the problem with this. Even a good thing can become a bad thing. Okay? Even a good thing in your life can become a bad thing. Even with the right intentions, it can still become an idol, even when you're pursuing the right things, if your eyes aren't on what's truly the object of what you're doing. Right? So their righteousness, the Pharisees, their righteousness, their thinking that they got everything right causes them to look down on others around them, okay? So if you look at Luke 18, 11 through 12, it says the Pharisee did what? Stood by himself and prayed. You notice he's off by himself. Righteous behavior. And he says, God, I thank you that I'm not like Janet, that I'm not like Leslie. Robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector, for example. I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of all I get. I mean, this is him praying. This is the context. This is the content of his prayers. Now, what I want to point out to you is that when you stand apart, there's no community for you. Do you realize that? When we're gathered in places like this and getting honest and real, we're in a community of faith where we're counting on each other to come alongside us, to lift us up, to spur us on, to finish this race of faith that at times is very difficult. And doing faith solo is never the way that God intended for you. And when you stand alone in your faith life, you're standing away from the community, one of the greatest riches that God can give you in your faith journey. I want to point that out for you. And I want to point out that no one in this room is greater than anyone else. That each and every single one of us are broken, dented, dirty, grimed up. And each and every single one of us are pursuing restoration. And each and every single one of us are in a different trajectory within that journey. So we're all going to be in different places in that. That's why the church is full of hypocrites. That's why we oftentimes behave badly. But the pursuit is the cross and trusting that restoration is possible and that it does happen. And we need each other, my friends, to do this. Iron sharpens iron, as the Bible says. You surround yourself with like-minded people, that's who you're gonna become like. Right? He also prays with his head up to heaven, and he prays about himself. You realize? He's talking about himself. God, thank you. I'm not like these other people, and I do all these self-righteous things. And whenever we find ourselves praying about ourselves rather than for ourselves, I just want to say pride has really crept in. Pride has really crept in. Pride, my friends, is like a sealant for dust and dirt and grime. And it may look good on the outside, but on the underneath, you're rusting out. You're just rusting out. Then you have the other person in this story, the tax collector, who also stands off at a distance. He also stands at a distance. But the reason he's standing at a distance is because no one likes this guy. Okay, this tax collector is a Jew who's working for the Romans. And how many of you ever seen like an Italian mob movie or show? You see how these guys go around and they take upon their own authority to place their own tax on small business, and they enforce that through violence, right? This is, I mean, the mob movies, it's not new stuff. It's been done. And that's what's happening here. This tax collector has his own entourage, has his own enforcers. He's on the payroll of Rome, but also has the freedom and little oversight to go around and overtax and pad his pockets. And he's also a Jewish man. So this is totally conspiring with the enemy. If you're in that culture, if you're in that context. No one likes this. He extorts with muscle, just like a mobster movie. And I want you to realize that this parable loses its power if you also don't recognize the dirt, the dust, the grime, the dents that is all sorts of covered this tax collector whom Jesus favors. The tax collector, he prays with his head down. He beats his chest. He's in mourning. He comes to a place of recognizing his sin as Jesus is speaking this to him. He's in grief. He prays, Lord, I am a sinner. Have mercy on me. It's a big difference. If we look at chapter 18, verse 14, he stood at the distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Here's why grace is amazing. We sang this morning. Well, how did you phrase that this morning, Sam? That we don't have an ordinary grace?
We have amazing
Ah, I like that. We have amazing grace with gusto, because the nature of God's grace is that it's given to us when we don't deserve it, when we haven't earned it, when we've done nothing to be righteous enough to have it, even if we may be misinformed about ourselves and our own righteousness. The point is, when we come humbly, God surprises us with grace. God surprises us with God's love. The one who admits his sins is made right with God, ultimately. Here's my point. Getting honest about the mess is the first step to being restored. You understand what I'm saying? Getting honest about the dirt, the dust, the grime, where we're rusted out underneath, that's the first step to restoration. You have to deal with the dirt and the grime to uncover the masterpiece, my friends. And not dealing with the grime is not restoration. You know what another great word for restoration is?
Transformation.
Tasty. But we also have to get honest to experience this stuff. And I want to point out that in our prayers and in our pursuit of doing this, praying about ourselves rather than for ourselves, that's not prayer. That's just religious activity. That's just religious activity. We have to own this. We have to own it. So my goal for you this Lent is for us to be able to do some soul work, to do some work on our own souls. I don't know if you can see this all that well, and I don't know for sure what's all in here. This is just a basket of junk. We moved to Cedar Falls 6 months ago, and one of the movers, this was kind of like the catch-all, the last remaining stuff that didn't go into boxes when we moved, and one of the movers set this right next to the door in the entryway to our garage. And you know what? It's been sitting there for 6 months. I've compartmentalized it nicely. I mean, it's safe, it's out of the way, it's in a nice little basket. I'm not tripping over it, but every time I go in and out of the door, I see this mess off to my right. And I got all sorts of stuff in here. We got a candle warmer. That's our internet password. Don't look at that. We got the Girl Scouts here today. Coincidentally enough, this doesn't fit so well, but this was my old Boy Scout uniform. I have no idea how that even got in there. I got a Michael Jordan jersey. Well, that's wrinkled. But I've managed to compartmentalize this mess. I know it's there, but I've brushed it off and compartmentalized it just enough so that it's not quite in the way, but it's reminding me, it's eating at me every time I walk in and out of my house. My friends, where there is no confession about our mess, where there is no addressing the mess, where there is no humility, and there's no restoration. There's no restoration in the midst of that, and furthermore, there's no transformation. And you know, when we're getting real about the mess, the entire pile can be pretty overwhelming. I look at this pile, I said, none of these things are related to each other. They go in completely different rooms of the house. And maybe that's why I just haven't touched it yet. It just seems like it's a little much to deal with. And I justify it. But maybe for you, it's not looking at the entire mess. It's looking at one piece of the mess. And just lifting that up to God and say, God, how about this one area that we can work on this Lent? This one place where I can be restored. This one place where I can experience transformation. And I want to encourage you in that this Lenten season. Even if you were to take one piece, to not only be honest with ourselves, but be honest with someone else. Someone else who can come alongside you, who can encourage you, who can pray for you, who can spur you on in this journey. Invite others into your mess. That's what church really is. Do you get that? Because we come to church sometimes with our shiny Sunday faces, like we're all put together and everything's great and grand. And we pray for birthdays and we pray for, you know, anniversary celebrations during prayer time. But it's amazing to me when we come into a place like this where we should be the most vulnerable and before God and before one another, where we know that everyone in here is supposed to have our back, that we don't bring up the real issues of sin in our life. Do you realize that? During our corporate prayer time, we're not asking people to say, this is my den. This is my grime. You know, and it's my hope and it's my prayer that's the kind of church that we can be, where we can get honest with each other about the mess and invite people into it with us to help carry the load. Because it's in community where we experience transformation. I was talking to a guy a couple weeks ago, and he says, I love my time with God every Sunday. I was like, where do you go to church? He says, well, I go to church on the golf course on Sunday. I said, well, how's that going for you? He's like, well, you should come with me. So one weekend when I was on vacation, I went with him to the golf course. I actually heard God's name quite a bit out there that morning, particularly every time he sliced. But we also had an opportunity to talk about the real dents and the real messes actually in both of our lives. And we got vulnerable before one another. And he came to realize that he couldn't do this by himself, that he needed a community to support him and come alongside him. Because do you realize what happened last week in these baptisms? That I didn't just ask these persons to profess their faith, but I turned to you. Do you remember this? And I said, will you do everything by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness to help support and uphold these persons in the faith, because they are counting on you. I may just quote myself again. That sounded nice, right? They're counting on you. We're counting on one another. Christianity is supposed to be a team sport, my friends. It's supposed to be, and better yet, it's a contact sport. Right? We're supposed to be rubbing elbows with each other. We're supposed to be getting in each other's lives and allowing transformation to happen in community. That's the nature and one of the key missions of the church. If you want change, you have to look at the mess and get others to pray for you. But furthermore, you have to be gentle with one another. You have to be gentle with one another. We can't have this stuff, oh, I'm so glad I'm not as dirty as Janet. I don't know why I keep picking on you this morning. You know, I'm thank God I'm not as messed up as Sam, you know. Whew. That doesn't work in a community of faith. When we realize that when Romans 3:23 tells us that we're all sinners, broken, dirty, dented, and damaged, in need of grace, and we've all fallen short of the glory of God, and we realize that we're all dust and we all come from the same stuff, it kind of levels the playing field at that point, does it not? And when we're honest about our place, it allows us to invite others into it, because we're going through the same stuff, ultimately. We're going through the same stuff. Here's my point. We are all broken. We're all dusty. We're all dented. And many of us... if we're really honest, many of us are just flat broken. And it's my hope and it's my prayer for us that we be that community of faith that says, we're all like this. And you know what? I need you. Because in baptism, you have said that you got my back, and I profess that I have yours as well. This next 5 weeks, we're going to be getting honest about our mess. And I'm going to invite you to invite others to come alongside you and to spur you on so that you can too be restored. You are a masterpiece. God makes beautiful things out of dust. And he makes beautiful things out of us. Hold on to that this Lent. It's in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit we pray. Amen. Amen.